explain his devotion to Averroism and his Spanish origin, his father's Granada, and all the lessons that the intolerant Spain of the Inquisition had taught him. And around 1548, he was sent to Regensburg as Charles V's ambassador in the religious affair. Diego was convinced that Charles V needed to bypass the Roman authorities and place the question of confessional divide on a purely political level. In March 1548, the formulation of the interim, a kind of agreement with the Lutherans, was complete and ready to be signed by the German. In mid-June, Charles' boldness and enterprise went even further, and he prepared a formula reformationis that also applied to the Catholic clergy. So the emperor obliged the entire ecclesiastical body to carry out the long-awaited moral reform. So the reform of the church, the agreement with the Protestants, the dream of a generation of Spanish humanists were at hand. But the Rome resistance was very strong. So Mendoza, Mendoza cursing los frailes, the friar, who nos destruye, and exasperated by the papal legates' continued obstruction tactics, wrote to Cardinal Granvelle, again master of the contemporary imperial politics, presenting a clear account of his position. So Rome's firm will to control everyone's conscience, to extend its power even over people's thought, was an absurd failure. And the example of how little has been achieved by the Inquisition policy of repression in Spain proved to everyone how difficult and useless it was to be in the court for forzar a los individuos, so forcing the unconscious of individuals in their private words. At this point, Mendoza's personal experience and his intellectual work crystallize in a decisive stand that it takes in a favor of a kind of tolerance, a very particular kind, but I would say that it's really a kind of tolerance. That comes from his philosophical preferences and also from his Spanish roots. And I quote, as a philosopher, say, Mendoza, or a Marrano, or a Moor, or Granada, he was convinced by what he had seen in Granada in Spain and then in the empire coming by the religious vision, that really the Spanish confessional ways was not the only one today. And I will not leave with that very interesting quotation of Mendoza, who says, "Es imposible forzar a los individuos, porque si yo soy un particular, no quiero ir a casa del legado, y el otro, y otro." This is a very particular situation. Así que el emperador puede disponer en general y el papa dispensar, pero no puede forzar, ni es posible en millares de años dispensar, forzar con los individuos de esta generalidad. Y esto hablo como filósofo, o como Borde Granada, o como Marrano, que aún hoy tiene la decisión más que hacer en España el primer día. Gracias.
Thank you. This was very useful. I have two things to say. One is, it seems to me in Venice, we know that Mendoza, while he was in Venice, acquired a whole number of books by Savonarola. And I think this is opening another layer to your construction, because in fact, it wasn't enough. I mean, there is that problem too, that he reacts to a kind of a Florentine flurry of expatriate literature that is already kind of polemical, but it is not in touch with any of the sort of proto-skeptical, you know, sort of pre-Montaigne, sort of, which I think you brought very, very well. But there is that internal sort of aspect, and he's a massive collector. He's probably the one that amasses the most number of Savonarola books in Venice, even more than the patricians at that time. So that's very puzzling, and I think it kind of it adds another layer to your reconstruction. But that's not only one thing. The most important thing I want to ask is this. For many, many years, we have had a model, because Mendoza is, as you said, is a collector. It's almost like the Renaissance idea of a collector. And for many years in Venice, we have understood that as a kind of a, you're either a patrician, or if you're not, you're emulating the patrician. So if you are, say, a homo novus, or somebody with money, but no particular prestige, your best bet is to try to buy some Giorgione or something like that to just appear good. But then Mendoza seems to me opens up a new dimension of collecting, which is something that has been discussed, not for Mendoza, but in general, by Monica Schmitter in Mansus Quarterly. Because she really says, we don't need to look at the patrician emulation as the only way, because there are other powerful cultural people in Venice who actually are practicing something else altogether. And it seems to me the Spanish emigrants, especially of that caliber, like Mendoza and a few others, I mean, they're really trying to do something that does not go into that direction that we have for so many years, which is kind of, you either are like a rainbow sort of person, or you're nobody. And so you, the only thing you can do is really buy, you know, buy enough to just kind of pretend to be. But it seems to me that this is a third way, which is interesting because it's about the cittadini, right? It's about the Venetians who were not a noble person, but neither they were sort of ominous novio. So it's kind of like a third way, and maybe the Spanish thing is the way to look at Venetian collecting, I mean, in large.
Thank you. No, that's remarks are extremely interesting, and yeah, I never thought about Mendoza collecting about that, but maybe it was part of also of a political strategy to enter into contact with Venetian, because we have to think that the basic alliance was with the Italians and the French ambassadors, and Mendoza was in struggle with it to conquer the Venetian. It's very interesting to think about that. Also, if you think of people that were around Mendoza, like Aretino, or people that were not that kind of...
They were not people of French.
And it's really, really interesting. And also the Savonarola, the Savonarola things is opening so much, so much question, so much path, because one thing that I skip, because first time is the time, but so Savonarola, one of the first codex of the sexist empirical was in San Marco in Florence. And at the very beginning of the 16th century, the work of Sextus, this codex of Sextus Empiricus, found a completely different way from the using the Mendoza was thinking about. So, and in the entire history of skepticism, the rediscovery of Sextus Empiricus can go in two very different and quite opposite ways. So, one is the way of fideism, of skepticism adopted by inside a religious tradition. So, if knowledge is so difficult, and if there could be no knowledge, so and no rational knowledge, so our faith is the basis. So it's a kind of fideistic. So. But we have a very Mendoza, of course, he was thinking of sex, so simply because in a very different way. If we you have to think about this this guy facing like the struggling within Catholic and Lutheran, and it was really in the year of Trent, he was exasperated by all the discussion on justification and on theological matters. So his way was is. If we cannot find anything sure about theological discussion and theological dogma, then we just have to skip it. So and solve the way in a very political. And there is a very interesting introduction with Pius de Castro did this Latin edition in which Pius de Castro said, as my master said, I'm sure that stuff could be used against the litigadores. Mm-hmm. So the litigadores in the time were Protestant. But really, Savonarola opened a lot of questions. One of that question is also the question of what means. So Mendoza struggled. Mendoza was part of was helping Cosimo to go over the Florentine refugee. So in some way we can see him as an anti-republican man, but I don't think his ideas is even more complex than that, because I don't want to open it too many, but maybe we can discuss later, but Mendoza in some way is a very republican man. In his way of facing, for example, the Siena involved. His sister, Maria Pacheco, was the wife of Juan de Padilla, so the leader of the Comunero revolt. And Mendoza was very close to his sister. And the memoir of his sister came into the Italian background as a kind of heirloom of refugees. So this is also a very, very intriguing and complex question. So thank you so much for it.
Thank you very much, Rob. I really enjoyed it. The anonymous prose work, Las Amigas Eternas, the name most frequently associated with speculation on who the author is Hurtado de Mendoza, and I wonder if you have a view on that. After hearing your talk, I'm more convinced that he may have been, but then I also have some doubt. But I wonder if you thought about that at all.
So at some point I stopped the story, but what I have to tell you is that all this attempt to find another solution abruptly stopped in 1552, when Charles V decided to break this kind of politic in Italy, decided to change, to switch to an alliance with the Pope and with Cosimo de' Medici. And Diego Hurtado de Mendoza was abruptly called back to Spain. He was the loser of the Siena War. He had a big quarrel with the Pope, and he was the only ambassador who was called back before he ended this. And at that time, his career was completely was ended completely. So in 1552, he came back to Madrid and then to Bruxelles, and he had a long trial about, economical trial about expenses he did in Siena, and a lot of problems with Charles V. And at that time, he was supposed to write also the Las Amigas Eternas, which is a very fascinating idea. But my personal idea is that he, at that time, he had to deal with much more practical and taking time for them without writing the Las Amigas. What I can say, and that is Mercedes Aguillo, from time to time, the Las Amigas Eternas was, Mendoza was saying to be the author of the Las Amigas Eternas. What I found, he has a very interesting prose, but I found his prose, particularly in the Guerra de Granada, quite different from the Las Amigas one, but I'm really not a biologist, so I can be wrong. I would say that in this time in which he should have written the Vasilio de Tormes, he was really struggling to face Charles V punishment against him.
But would you think differently? Most critics these days think that it was written closer to 1530 or so. Would you think differently if it had been not around 1552 that it's being written, but more towards 1530 or so?
What I think is that the thing that we have a manuscript edition of the Lazarillo among the Mendoza staff can just assure ourselves that he was a very, very curious and eclectic man. So I'm not. I can understand that some maybe people who wrote the last video gave the manuscript, and I would not be shocked at that hypothesis. Mm-hmm. And a little more, we have not real strong evidence for that, and my own little, I would love, but I don't think he wrote also the last video with us.
Thank you.
I was wondering about the idea of skepticism. I mean, maybe this is kind of an unfair question, but the idea of skepticism in the context of natural history, if you have found evidence that that's something that maybe is going on Natalia Mendoza, because you mentioned that he was a humanist, he was a collector. I'm like in a constant dialogue about this with Miguel, and I was amazed that he told me yesterday we were talking about Arias Montano and how Arias Montano has also who's like more famous about his philological editions and kind of religious treatises. Also Hernandez wrote as well. Well, these are kind of like a generation later kind of figures, but still, I mean, they both seem to have one thing in like the more like humanist tradition, and another one in natural history debates around that kind of, academic environments going on in Italy and stuff. And I know Giovio, for instance, was widely written by the time in Spain by some intellectuals like Antonio Torquemada. Giovio is frequently quoted in the Jardín de Flores Curiosas. So I was wondering if you think that idea of skepticism is like maybe applicable to the kind of natural history debate.
Let's skepticism as a specific philological, philosophical doctrine, I'm not so sure. What I can say is that Diego Hurtado de Mendoza was very interested in materialism. He did his big job was a Spanish translation of the Mechanics of Aristotle, which was a huge work, and it was really interesting in that. He had Pepe Pardo Tomás, and he was studying the Herbarium of Diego Hurtado de Mendoza, which was one of the biggest herbarium collected. Herbarium is the right? Yeah, herbarium collected in Spain. So, he was also was also very interested in maths. He was one of the protagonists of the Cartago in maths. So he really had also strong, very very strong and close link with the mathematician and materialist in Italy and in Spain. if his idea of the skepticism was connected with the naturalist and with the natural science study, I have to think about that. I'm not so sure right now, but maybe you can you can give me some more ideas on that.
Did I ask another? But if there's somebody else, I'm going to hand up. I'm not quite sure how to ask this. It's only fairly recently that I've become somewhat interested in discussions of one's conscience or consciences. So I was struck by the translation in which it's impossible to force, and then in the translation, it says force consciences or an individual's conscience. And I wondered what preceded that. And also, I'm new to thinking about the conscience. But in doing so, I'm more familiar with French and English interest in the conscience. So I'm sort of wondering how big a topic the conscience is. And one could imagine, without it being specified in that particular paragraph, one could imagine a translation saying they can't force someone to believe or they can't force someone to accept the truth. So I'm wondering what preceded that caused you to use conscience so deliberately.
So partly it's because of my bad English, so I do not take something from my translation. But I think that this concept for los individuos y forzar is always to think about your internal belief and your internal conscience. So for that reason, I use and I maybe explain a bit more than I would suppose to. So I'm really thinking that here is thinking about the inside, the inner,
I see.
The inner conscience, and then if you think about Inquisition, what is doing it in a way is something very related to the modern idea of consciousness.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about your comment on those of the Arabists. So this Arabic manuscripts are in the Inquisitorial now.
Yes.
What sorts of commentaries are there, or what types of commentary on?
This topic of the knowledge of Arabic of Diego Hurtado de Mendoza was a very big topic, because Diego Hurtado de Mendoza, of course, was saying a lot of things that maybe you are not. Until now, we have these two references that make him make us think that people don't know Arabic. So, the Ambrosio de Morales, who was a scholar of him, and in the BKT was saying that he was very he could read and write Arabic, and the but there is and there's a, sorry, but I can't remember the name, but there is a student, a PhD student in Brunel, who is exactly focusing on the knowledge of Arabic of Diego Hurtado de Mendoza, and he found, sorry, I can't remember his name right now, but I will put you in contact with him. The Hurtado de Mendoza Arabic treasure was partially lost during the the fire of the Escurial, but still there are some codexes that I thought that he was working on Avicen codex of Diego Hurtado de Mendoza that are annotated. So that would help us the other way in which we know that Diego Hurtado de Mendoza, but it's also quite a debated question, is that at some point in the Guerra de Granada, he was saying that he built with the codex the King of Tunis gave to him, so deal with Arabic sources more than Christian sources.
This was a common.
Yeah, this is a common. All that kind of. So we can think about common places in the case of we don't know if he was really saying a lie or if it was a common place or that. But that guy is doing a quite interesting job on the Mendoza Arabic products and seems to be that Mendoza really. New Arabic, as Manuzio was confessing, Manuzio has no way to know if he would effectively know Arabic or not. So, that is
all. I would like to ask something about the Jesuits in the first week. So, which is the role of Spanish Jesuits in this? Story, especially in the Traslatio Studi or in the Morisco culture in Italy. And there's something that you find in the story with the conversos, Girolamo Busale, writing, and also there are Polonies, Jesuits Polonies in Italy, like Alfonso San Marone. So, what they brought to Italy?
I don't know, maybe. From your book, from reading your book, I can say that the other ambassador, Loco de Soria, Juan de Andres. Do you think that San Marone wrote something? I'm asking it to you. There's a lot of Arabic stuff, for example, wrote by Jesuit, but in a later period. So at the end of 16th century and the 17th century and Las Casas, Ignacio Las Casas, for example, and the strong relationship with. I don't know. Yeah, I simply don't know. I have no evidence of a Jesuit role, particularly of San. Why are you thinking of San Marón?
About politics and purgatory and things that they use Morisco sources, but there is no overlapping.
Morisco sources on the politics of?
Yeah. Well, it's like Ghazali and some of these things. And they are the same period, so.
But they are Arabic products or just polemical sources? You should tell me. I don't know.
I'm just curious, thanks for this talk. This is not, I mean, I'm more of a modernist, so that might sound like this. But when he said that Corpse stayed as Morano, considering his nationality, if Morano then was taken as a way to express skepticism, so would that be a sort of valid way to push against nationality, or and then to promote the notion of humankind, or I mean, what? Because I'm just disturbed by the notion of Morano as the nationality. Are there any other instances of such uses?
So the Margaret term in Italy at that time was very used.
As
was a polemical term that was used against Spaniards in general, but was also a polemical term that at some point, I think around 1530s, turned around to be also not also a kind of racist and ethnical term that was basically saying that you were a Spanish or converso origin, but also something that was very close to the unbeliever.
Right, yeah, so I'm just wondering if he's not using this sort of multi-layered discourse.
Yes, it's a multi-layered term that, for example, Ariosto was using it as just as a traitor. Or other writers are using it as kind of an unbeliever. And for example, the Pastore against Mendoza, because you do not believe and you were born and you will die as an Arano without. So there's many shift on that term. So I don't know if I can answer to the question, but it's rather it's this history of stereotype and stereotype term that is rather sleeping.
All right, well, thank you very much.